What happens if you only have one fallopian tube? Can you still get pregnant? Okay, maybe you can get pregnant, but are the chances significantly less? Maybe they're cut in half. Maybe you have half of the fertility potential that you did before you lost that fallopian tube. This is such a common misconception, and I'm excited to teach you more about why you can still get pregnant with one fallopian tube. I'm Dr. Lora Shahine. I'm a double board certified OBGYN and reproductive endocrinologist, counseling people about anatomy and fallopian tubes for over 20 years. And I love educating. I'm so glad you found this channel. If this is your first time here, hit that subscribe button so you can continue to find my reproductive health videos that come out every week. There's two other ways to stay in touch and stay informed about reproductive health. Number one, sign up for my newsletter. It's my weekly newsletter, all about educational content and recommendations that I have. And number two is my podcast. Comes out an episode out every week. It is in my podcast playlist on YouTube. You can find it on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, anywhere you listen to podcasts. I love teaching about reproductive health. Sometimes it's a one-on-one interview with someone in the field or an infertility warrior. There's so much to learn. So my newsletter, my podcast, and welcome to my YouTube channel. Today, we are talking about fertility with one fallopian tube. So, there are many reasons that people might have one fallopian tube. And a lot of times, people are asking, what does this mean for my fertility? There are five main topics we're going to cover today. Number one, we'll go over the anatomy of the fallopian tube and its role in conception. Number two, we'll go over reasons why people might only have one fallopian tube. Number three, we'll go over why people worry about their fertility if they only have one fallopian tube. Topic number four, we will review the evidence around fertility rates with one fallopian tube. And topic number five, we'll go over treatment options if you have one fallopian tube. Now, stick around to the end of the video where I'll tell you how I counsel my own patients. Topic number one, the anatomy of the fallopian tube and its importance for getting pregnant. So I have my stuffed uterus. This is the anatomy. So this is the uterus. The bottom of the uterus is the cervix, and this is going out of the body. At the top of the uterus, there's a fallopian tube, and these are the ovaries. Now, I know with a stuffed uterus, it looks like everything is attached, but the fallopian tube and the ovary are not actually attached. There's a little ligament on one end where they're kind of close to each other, but there are these fimbria at the tip of the fallopian tube that kind of come over and kind of reach over the ovary around the time of ovulation. And when the egg ovulates, the egg sits on the surface of the ovary. Sometimes it kind of goes into the pelvis, like just pops out of the ovary, and the fallopian tube and the fimbria come and pick it up. The egg goes into the fallopian tube. This is where fertilization happens. So the sperm, if you have intercourse, the sperm swims up through the uterine cavity into the fallopian tube. This is where fertilization happens. Egg and sperm meet, fertilize. The embryo starts developing for the first about 5, 6 days. And then the embryo, which is a fully formed embryo called a blastocyst, travels down into the uterine cavity and implants for pregnancy. So, fallopian tubes are key for getting pregnant. You have to have at least one open fallopian tube to ovulate, have the egg get into the fallopian tube, and meet the sperm in order to get pregnant. Now, what's amazing is I know that this is what it looks like on a stuffed uterus. And in textbooks, it looks like the fallopian tubes are stuck straight out like this and kind of attached to the ovaries. But that's not how it works in the body. These float around a little bit. And when you are kind of looking in the body, like doing a laparoscopy, kind of up here, fallopian tubes, and the ovaries kind of hang out sort of sometimes behind the uterus, kind of down here in the pelvis. What I'm trying to show and what I'm trying to say in lots of different ways is that fallopian tubes are not stuck like they are in a picture book of anatomy. They move around. And so this fallopian tube can pick up an egg from that ovary. So the right fallopian tube can pick up an egg from the left ovary, and the left fallopian tube can pick up an egg from the right ovary. It is not this static thing that a right ovary has to put an egg into the right fallopian tube, and that's the only way that you're going to get pregnant that month. The anatomy is amazing. The structures are kind of mobile and sort of next to each other in the pelvis. And we know that people can get pregnant with one fallopian tube when they're ovulating from the other ovary, because one of the things that we do a lot of times when we're doing fertility treatment is we're doing ultrasounds in the middle of the cycle to look at the ovaries and figure out when the egg is going to ovulate. And the eggs grow in these fluid-filled structures called follicles. And the follicle gets to be about 18 to 20 millimeters. And that's when you're ready for ovulation. We know the egg pops out. And so we can see which ovary ovulates. So we could know that someone is missing a right fallopian tube because they had it removed for one reason or another. And that in the cycle, when they get pregnant, we know they ovulated from the left ovary. And this has happened to me multiple times in my, fertility doctor career. People are surprised and excited, but it can absolutely happen. So it's important to understand the anatomy. It's important to understand how mobile it is and how one fallopian tube can work with both ovaries. Topic number two, how can somebody only have one fallopian tube? Aren't we all born with two? Reasons people can only have one fallopian tube is, number one, congenitally, they are born without the fallopian tube. Number two, could have been surgically removed for one reason or another. And number three, that fallopian tube could be blocked, maybe from infection or inflammation from endometriosis. So they haven't had surgery. They were born with two fallopian tubes, but one of the fallopian tubes is just not working. So you can figure out if you have two open fallopian tubes by, number one, you can see them surgically. So if somebody's having a laparoscopy for one reason or another, the doctor can say, yep, I looked and you've got two fallopian tubes. You can even do something called chromotubation, where during a laparoscopy or a surgery, they can flush the fallopian tubes with fluid coming up through the cervix and watch the dye spill into the pelvis and say, hey, yep, both of those fallopian tubes are open. The way to know that fallopian tubes are open or not without surgery is a test called a hysterosalpingogram. And I have got videos here on YouTube telling you all about the hysterosalpingogram. HSG test is a test that is, it's not a surgery, but it is a procedure that's putting fluid through the cervix into the uterine cavity and then watching with fluoroscopy or like real-time x-rays to see the fluid flush through the fallopian tubes. And sometimes you can, of course, you can see that one of the fallopian tubes is blocked. It's not filling up with fluid, or maybe out here it's not spilling with fluid. And you say, the fallopian tube is blocked, but that doesn't mean that you're necessarily not going to be able to get pregnant if you ovulate from the same ovary where the tube is blocked. So remember, these are the reasons people might not have two open and functioning fallopian tubes. Number one, they could be born that way. Number two, the tube could be surgically removed, maybe in the treatment of an ectopic pregnancy or some other surgical need to remove a fallopian tube, but ectopic pregnancy is the most common. And number three, the tube could be blocked for some reason, like infection or inflammation. They're not exactly sure why it's blocked, but it's not functioning. Topic number three, why do people worry about having lower fertility with only one fallopian tube? I mean, I just explained the anatomy, but of course you can worry about that. It's from a lot of misconceptions. Common misconception is that the anatomy is the way it is shown in textbooks, and that if, you can only pick up a egg from the same ovary that a functioning fallopian tube is next to. I explained why that's not the case, but it's really common to worry that it is. Another reason people worry about it is, especially if you have that misconception, you can think to yourself, oh, well, it's like I'm only ovulating from the right ovary half of the time. So a lot of people think it's like back and forth, like right ovary and then left ovary and then right ovary. That's actually not the case. It's like flipping a coin. You could ovulate from your right ovary three cycles in a row, or it could be left, right, left, left. It's random, and it's like flipping a coin. So not understanding anatomy, not understanding how ovulation works or how the ovaries work, I mean, it's really common to be worried. So if you've been worried about this, you are not alone. Of course, when you are struggling to conceive and you have a test that says that one of your fallopian tubes is blocked, you're going to worry, oh my gosh, that is one of the reasons I'm not getting pregnant. Or if you have an ectopic pregnancy and your tube is removed as treatment for that ectopic pregnancy, that's a pregnancy in the fallopian tube, then of course you're going to be worried about your ability to get pregnant again if that's your goal. I completely understand why people are worried about their fertility, and that's why I made this video. This is why I'm talking about it today so that you can understand more. Topic number four, what does the evidence show? Like, okay, you're so reassuring, Dr. Shaheen, that my fertility is okay, but is it really? And it's been looked at in multiple different ways, and we've got some studies to share with you. So one study, it's an old study from 1997, published in Fertility and Sterility, tried to answer this question and did it in a unique way. So they were looking at anybody that had had a tubal ligation, you know, tubes tied in order to not get pregnant, but they wanted to reverse the tubal ligation, do a tubal reanastomosis surgery in order to try to get pregnant again. And in 126 women that were undergoing tubal reanastomosis, or kind of reversing a tubal ligation, they looked at if they were successful with both fallopian tubes or maybe only one fallopian tube, and then they looked at time to pregnancy. They did the tubal reanastomosis and then they did follow up to see if both of the fallopian tubes were open or maybe only one. In 35 of the cases, only one of the fallopian tubes was remained open afterwards, and then they followed time to conception for 2 years after the reanastomosis surgery. One open and functioning fallopian tube had the same chance of success as people with two open and working fallopian tubes. Another way of looking at this is an interesting study of people who were getting tubal recannulization. So these are people who maybe did an HSG or a laparoscopy, but they found that the fallopian tubes were blocked. And so they did this special procedure called a tubal recannulization, where you actually put a little instrument up through the uterine cavity and try to open the fallopian tube just with high pressure kind of fluid. So you're just trying to, if there's anything that's blocking the fallopian tube, you're just trying to kind of push it out. And the 61 patients that they followed, 41% of the patients got pregnant, and it was a similar pregnancy rate whether one fallopian tube was open or both fallopian tubes were open with this recanalization. One final way of trying to answer this question in a particular setting is looking at time to conception or fertility after loss of a fallopian tube in the setting of a treatment of an ectopic pregnancy. So studies will look at this in lots of different ways, but overall, the findings are very reassuring that fertility is still good. Time to conception does not dramatically change after loss of a fallopian tube in the setting of an ectopic pregnancy. Topic number five, treatment for one fallopian tube. Well, what I mean by this is if you find that you have a blocked fallopian tube on a hysterosalpingogram, that HSG test, it could be a false finding. No test is 100% accurate. And so sometimes people investigate it further, like do a laparoscopy and sort of see if the fluid could be flushed through in that way, or there's any scarring kind of around the fallopian tube that could be fixed. Sometimes people will have that finding on an HSG and either repeat the study to make sure it's accurate or do investigation further, like with a laparoscopy. Also, sometimes people have done that tubal recanalization procedure where you're flushing the fallopian tube from inside the cavity. It's not a huge part of my practice, but that is something that I know people have done, and there's studies about it in the literature. If that tube is blocked or you're missing that fallopian tube, what I hope that you're taking away from this is that doesn't mean that your fertility is necessarily 50% less, that that other fallopian tube can absolutely be functioning and you can still try to conceive without intervention. Just because you have a blocked or missing fallopian tube doesn't mean that you automatically have to do fertility treatment. Now, if someone has two blocked fallopian tubes or there's tubal disease, you know, in both tubes, that's actually why IVF was invented. IVF at its core is bypassing fallopian tubes. I'm not saying that people with only one fallopian tube have to do IVF. I'm just explaining that that is at its core, you know, what it is. So instead of the egg and sperm fertilizing in the fallopian tube, the embryo coming down and implanting into the uterine cavity, with IVF, you get the eggs out of the body, you get a sperm sample, and fertilization is happening in the lab. In vitro fertilization, IVF, not intratubal fertilization in the body, but in vitro in the lab, IVF. And then when the embryo is ready, you help people get pregnant by putting it through the cervix and into the uterine cavity. So you don't even need fallopian tubes to get pregnant with IVF. You just need eggs, sperm, and a uterus. So I really want to emphasize, I'm not saying that people with one fallopian tube have to do IVF to get pregnant, but I just wanted to explain a little bit about options that are out there. So in closing, we've talked about, you know, anatomy of a fallopian tube, how people could have only one fallopian tube, how to test for it and find out. And I really want you to take away this reassurance that just because you have one fallopian tube, that does not mean that you cannot get pregnant without assistance. And so when I'm talking to my patients about this, I go through all of these things that we talked about here. Like you know, often we'll say your tubes aren't like this. They're not stuck out here. They move and they can grab, you know, the egg from the other ovary. I explain anatomy. I explain ovulation, how it's not just like automatically back and forth from right to left. And I really try to reassure people. And then we come up with a plan. So I'm sort of like, listen, all your other tests are very reassuring. Just because you have a blocked fallopian tube or you're missing a fallopian tube, let's just continue to try, you know, expectant management, but come back and see me in 3 to 6 months. If you aren't pregnant then, let's go through all the options again. So learning, explanation, education, and then coming up with a long-term plan that is right for that particular patient. So I hope this was valuable. I hope it was reassuring. Like this video if you learned something. Comment with questions that you have. Be sure and subscribe to this channel so you get my weekly videos all about reproductive health. And until next week, wishing you love, luck, and pineapples.